Good morning, Your Honors. May it please the court. My name is Wendy Motooka, and I represent the appellants, Deputy Timothy Jones and Deputy Joseph Reeve in this case. Defendant appellants, Deputy Jones and Reeve, asked this court to reverse the court below and grant qualified immunity for the use of deadly force based on the facts taken in the light most favorable to plaintiff to the extent supportable by the record. That is the settled standard for interlocutory review of denial of a qualified immunity summary judgment motion.
So, counsel, as you, and I think this will front kind of what we're concerned about, or at least I have some concerns in this case, how you just stated the standard for oral argument in your oral presentation seems to be quite different from how you argued the standard in your briefs. And so maybe you can address that, because as I read your briefs, there was a lot of discussion about whether the factual findings or how the facts should be taken. And as you're probably aware, we have said we don't have interlocutory jurisdiction to decide that question. So can you tell us why we have jurisdiction here when the argument seems to have been in the briefs that that the facts are just, you know, wrong?
The argument in the brief is that the facts taken in the light most favorable to plaintiff have to be the facts supportable by the record. That's the standard in Scott versus Harris. That's the standard that we cited in the brief. That was the very issue addressed in the Isayeva versus Berry case that the court asked us to prepare to address today. In Isayeva, this court found that it had jurisdiction to decide the qualified immunity appeal, even though the district court had characterized its denial of qualified immunity as resting on issues of material fact, genuine issues of material fact. In the present case, the district court is characterizing its ruling as resting on factual disputes, yet it has not identified the factual disputes. It merely treats as disputed facts that are undisputed, and that's at ER 9 of the court's order. It merely treats as disputed facts that are undisputed. The question now raised is, can a district court deny qualified immunity and insulate itself from review simply by treating facts as disputed in the absence of any record evidence creating an issue? We already have the answer to this question in Scott versus Harris. The answer is no. The relevant facts for determining qualified immunity are those most favorable to plaintiff to the extent supportable by the record. The Sixth Circuit has interpreted Scott versus Harris to mean that, quote, where the trial court's determination that a fact is subject to reasonable dispute is blatantly and demonstrably false, a court of appeals may say so, even on interlocutory appeal.
Let me interrupt. So if we take the facts that are most favorable for the plaintiff, which you agree is the standard, how does that help you? And how do you get qualified immunity? The facts most favorable to the plaintiff create all sorts of issues of fact and all sorts of concerns. I don't understand how you get to where you want to go if you accept that premise.
The facts most favorable to the plaintiff, to the extent supportable by the record, right? To the extent that there's evidence in the record that would support that fact, are that Mr. Shannon swung an AR-15 towards the deputies, causing the first shot to be fired, and then aimed a handgun at the deputies, which resulted in the fatal shots being fired. That's undisputed.
That's most favorable for the plaintiff?
Based on the facts in the record.
Most favorable for the defendant. That's not what the plaintiff is saying at all.
The plaintiff is saying there was no second gun, which the district court roundly rejected.
Go ahead, Judge Black.
It just seems that this is laden with all sorts of factual issues that are really in dispute here. And if that is the case, then I don't think we have jurisdiction. You're telling me that there are no disputed facts here, and therefore we should exercise interlocutory jurisdiction in this case.
Yes, there are no disputed facts here. So,
well, hold on a second. You said, I mean, didn't you just present a disputed fact? I don't know if it's disputed, but you said he brought a gun, but it wasn't a gun, right? The question was where the gun was, how the gun was being held and where it was being pointed, right?
Right, and that is not disputed in the record. The only evidence on how the gun was being manipulated was the testimony of the deputies.
I thought the deputies didn't give consistent statements on how the gun was being held.
Well, there are two uses of force at issue here. Are you referring to the first use of force or the second use of force?
Well, let's talk about the rifle. My question is just a factual one. I'm not sure which one it relates to right now. Probably the first one, I guess. Didn't one deputy say that he was holding the rifle in his hand, but the other said that he was holding it pointing down? And one had it more horizontal and one was more vertical?
No, both of them said he was holding it parallel to the ground. There's a video demonstration in the videotape.
Yeah, that's what I'm looking at here.
In the videotaped deposition, both of them said that the rifle was parallel to the ground, barrel forward, and that he swung around towards them, which is what caused the first shot. The discrepancy in the record is whether he swung clockwise or counterclockwise. And on the record, I think you could assume whichever direction is more favorable to plaintiff, we would assume that. But I don't think it makes a difference in terms of the reasonableness of the force used. The court on the first use of force, the district court on the first use of force, is saying the tribal issue is whether or not the use of force was reasonable. That's a classic province of interlocutory review on the first use of force.
Let me ask you this question, all right? Let's assume that you're entitled to qualified immunity on the first shot, all right? To me, the second one is really factually in dispute in many, many respects. But if we were to conclude that you were entitled to qualified immunity, as you just argued on the first shot, but we don't think you're entitled to qualified immunity on the second shot, we have some partial jurisdiction to handle those things discreetly, or would we have to send it back on the grounds that we lack jurisdiction?
I think you clearly have jurisdiction over this case on both uses of force, because... Yeah.
You're not answering my question. I'm just curious. Let's assume we agree on the first shot, but not on the second. What's our jurisdictional posture in that case?
I think you would grant qualified immunity on the initial use of force and then send it back on the second if you thought there was a tribal issue. But we have the record in front of us here. And what we
We've been having these cases for some time, and I was on one of the panels that laid out a lot of the law. And it's very difficult. I understand why you want to get there, because you want to get a different immunity involved. And so that's what the fight is, how much deference you're going to give to the police officers. But this case is very much like other cases we've had in the Ninth Circuit, where we have not allowed that to take place. What is your best case in this circuit for your position? That is that we will treat a factual situation which has not gone to any type of judgment, that we have jurisdiction on appeal. What's your best case that we have jurisdiction to take that segment only and thrive?
The first segment?
Yes, just that one point. This case hasn't been tried yet, has it?
It has not been tried, because qualified immunity should be raised at the earliest possible stage. And so we raised it on summary judgment, and I think what we have is a district court decision that treats as disputed facts that are not disputed. And that, in effect, denies qualified immunity from being heard at the earliest stage. If you look at the way the court's order is—
Okay, where's your Ninth Circuit case that gives you that jurisdiction? When one part of the case that has a lot of issues that we can take that little piece and come up and handle it at the appellate level.
I think that's just the doctrine of qualified immunity itself, that it would be resolved at the earliest issue.
No, it is. You won't find a Ninth Circuit case that says that. And I know because I think it's a good idea. I think this, the qualified immunity issue, you get to it, it solves a lot of problems. Usually it gets a settlement very quickly. But when the last time I was in this was just a year ago, year and a half ago, and we could find no cases nor any way that we could carve that part of the case out. So I would like to know where our jurisdiction is to do this. I mean, you've had a decision on one aspect of the case, but there's more to go. If you came up just on that, you'd still have to test the qualified immunity. You'd have to have the court look at the issues and see if it's appropriate. So where's the jurisdiction to take that part of the case and come up before the case is tried?
Well, I don't concede.
What's your best case?
I don't concede that there is a factual issue in this case. So perhaps Barry Isayeva would be a case in point where the district court is.
Which case?
Barry versus Isayeva. I mean, sorry, Isayeva versus Barry, the case that the court referred us to in its order.
Yeah.
In that case, the district court is characterizing the denial of qualified immunity as resting on disputed issues of fact. But this court took jurisdiction because those were, in fact, not disputed issues of fact relevant to the qualified immunity analysis. And I think the exact same thing is going on here.
Well, but that resolved the whole case, right? I think here, even if there's not a disputed issue, let's say a material disputed issue of fact on the first shot, there does seem to be a disputed fact. I mean, the second shot, there's a question of whether the handgun was pointing at the officers or not. And if we could we resolve the first shot and say there's qualified immunity there, but we don't have jurisdiction over the second shot? Or do we have to just, I think this is where Judge Wallace is going, or do we just have to say, look, there's disputed issues of fact on one of the issues that's up before us, therefore we lack jurisdiction?
That's my concern also. I'm just curious about this bifurcated dynamic.
Well, I don't concede that it's a bifurcated dynamic, because I think if there's a disputed issue of fact in terms of where the gun was pointed when the fatal shots were fired, where is it in the record? The court expressly does not find that. The court says that because there isn't corroborating evidence.
Listen, assume hypothetically we disagree with you and we find that there really are serious issues of fact on the second shot. The question that Judge Wallace and Judge Nelson and myself are concerned about is that, do we have jurisdiction to in effect bifurcate these two dynamics? Say we have jurisdiction over the first shot, but not over the second shot. I understand your argument, but factually I want you to make that assumption and tell us whether you think we have partial jurisdiction.
I think you do, because I think under the purpose for qualified immunity, which is an immunity from trial, the fact that there is no dispute, if the court finds there's no disputed fact as to the reasonableness of the first shot, why would the deputy go to trial on that?
Okay. But there's no case in Judge Pippen's part that says that exactly right now. I don't think, I haven't found any.
I'm unaware of any case in which two separate uses of force were being litigated at the same time with different decisions on the qualified immunity. If I may reserve some time for rebuttal.
Yeah, absolutely, counsel. Thank you.
All right, thank you.
Thank you for your argument.
Mr. Gorski.
Thank you, Your Honor. May it please the court. My name is Gary Gorski, and I represent the plaintiff and appellee in this case. And before I proceed, I just want to make the court aware that tomorrow, pending at the United States Supreme Court, that they have approximately 13 qualified immunity cases on conference. And when I reviewed those cases, one out of the Fifth Circuit, that was an unusual case because that went to a full jury trial on the issue of qualified immunity. So there is obviously a split in the circuits as to how they are dealing with this. But at the end of the day, qualified immunity is going to be fact specific. In fact, in the opening brief of the appellants on page 10, they discussed undisputed facts, which are actually disputed in the court's order. On page 13, they point out that pre-existing law has to be fact specific. And as this court recognizes, in this particular case, there's no fact specific case like this. And
Can I ask a question on, because it is something I think your colleague had touched on it. Is there a dispute of facts on the second shot in particular, or is it just not corroborated? That is to say, the officer, I mean, here it's a very unfortunate situation, obviously, because we don't have the defendant's the plaintiff's testimony about anything that happened because he's deceased. But we have the officers who've said and relayed what he was saying to them. And then we have another witness who apparently overheard some parts of it and just didn't mention some of the things the officer said. Do we take that as a dispute, or do we take that as it just wasn't corroborated? You know, it wasn't corroborated, so we have to accept what the officer said because there's no one there to dispute it.
Well, I think it's the inconsistency that make it a dispute, because it's like, how much weight do you give that type of evidence? And so the totality of the circumstances at that point in time, where the officers were talking to the victim here for approximately 3 minutes. Keep in mind, he had already dropped the plastic toy gun the first time after the first shot was fired, and pulled out the second toy airsoft pistol, and the officers were talking to him at the same time. He's yelling, "Shoot me, shoot me, shoot me." He's not really doing anything with the plastic toy. And I think a person.
So what's the dispute? What's the disputed fact on the second shot then? Because what you seem to be saying is it's not a disputed fact about what the officers heard him say.
That is correct. That the shoot me, shoot me, shoot me, I think that's undisputed. But what the officers are really relying upon is that he somehow flashed the barrel towards them over this approximately 3 minute span.
And on the handgun.
On the handgun, correct. On the plastic rifle.
So can I back up? Where's the disputed fact on that? The officer said he flashed the barrel of the handgun at them. What's the disputed fact on that issue? Where is the fact that says he didn't do that?
There's no specific fact on that. I think the judge.
And is it disputed?
But as that he flashed the handgun, I think it's disputed because of the passage of time, and that they had time to do things there, that that it was questionable whether they were actually threatened by any movement of that plastic handgun in the victim's hand.
Well, hold on a second. So what is the disputed factor? That's the thing I've been struggling with here is, it feels like there's a disputed fact, but when you dig into it, I don't know if it really is a disputed fact or if it's just not corroborated, or that there's an alternate theory out there, which is apparently what you're now proposing, is that, well, we don't know. Even if you credit the officer's testimony that the barrel turned towards them, there's no evidence that the shot was fired at that time. It may be that the barrel pointed towards them, he dropped the gun, and then the officer shot. Is that your argument?
Okay, he dropped the first rifle, But before that barrel, I think the record's clear on that, that the barrel wasn't being pointed at the officers, that the officer fired one shot from his handgun. Officer Reed, who had the AR-15, did not shoot in that circumstance. And
hold on, that's the first shot sure. You're talking about there, right? So are you conceding that there's no factual dispute on the first shot?
There is they're arguing that they were feared for their safety and that it was reasonable, even though the barrel wasn't being flashed towards them. Keep in mind that when they approached him, he was carrying this toy by its buttstock, which the district court had to define by going on to a dictionary.
I think I just heard you say there's no disputed fact on the first question.
On how he was carrying the weapon. That's what I was, when the officers first approached him, he was carrying the toy by its buttstock with the barrel facing to the ground. Then there was the dispute, did he cradle it? Did he hold it in his hands? And that comes from the deposition testimony and the declarations of the officers. There was inconsistency in there.
So can I back up and try to explain a few facts here, if I may, please? I think that the officers' justification in both these shots is that they felt that their safety was at risk, that it was in self-defense. And it seems that there are a host of facts here. They had the lights that were flashing that were arguably blinding this person. I don't know where they were located. I read part of the record that they were behind their cars, that they were shielded from harm, perhaps. I'm confused about that. I'm also don't know how far away they were when the shots were made with this high-powered rifle. I just think that there are a host of concerns here as to whether it truly was a situation where they justifiably feared for their safety and that warranted them taking this action. Certainly the second shot seems to be really factually laden. And he's standing there for some indeterminate period of time saying, shoot me, kill me, kill me. It just seems that there are so many factual matters that have to be explored in terms of the credibility as the officers and all of these issues. And also, as Judge Nelson pointed out, I think we have law in the circuit that says if the person is not able to testify because he's dead, that you have to really look at this in a more deferential way. Don't all these things add up to really saying that you just can't willy-nilly grant qualified immunity, maybe in both of those dynamics? Certainly in respect to the second shot.
Precisely, Your Honor, we point that out even in my opposition to the motion to strike I filed about 10 o'clock last night. There's the totality of circumstances. Did the officer shine a flashlight in his eye from his own personal weapon? The officers say they put the floodlights on the victim. So how could the victim see the officers? And this is happening at 2 o'clock in the morning, and as the officers passed by Mr. Shannon, they apparently saw him carrying what looked like a rifle by its buttstock. They turned around and approached him, but he didn't react to the officers first passing them. So there's those types of issues there as to that, that attack the credibility of what the officers are actually saying that helps them. And I think a trier of fact could see that the officers were unreasonable just by the outlying general facts. That's the other part of the problem. The record is very vague at the lower court, even on what is an AR-15. They just use that as a term of art, as if everyone knows what an AR-15 is. And it's used throughout
We don't have those in Brooklyn. We possibly can use them, but we don't have them in Brooklyn.
So I agree that there's a lot of gray areas here that have not been explored in the record by the defendants, and they purposely left those blanks there for the court to fill in. And as you pointed out, when the victim is dead and there's no one to testify for him, that they give the victim some deference, so he can actually speak, he or she can speak from the grave. And I think that's important.
I have a question how this got up here. There's a part of the case that was tried. Was there a judgment? Was there a finding Was there summary judgment? What did they appeal that the district court did?
They moved for summary judgment on qualified immunity, and this appeal.
Yes.
And there was no other adjudication of facts in the case. Everything was disposed of by the motion for summary judgment. Part of the case was going to proceed forward to trial, and they appealed where the judge denied qualified immunity in the lower court.
And so it's up here on a denial of qualified immunity.
Correct, on an interlocutory.
On summary judgment.
Correct, Your Honor.
Okay, well, that's the similar situation that the last time that our circuits had an issue like this, two police officers facing a young person that turns around with a fake AK, and they ask him to stop. They did all the right things but they end up shooting and killing him. But I don't say even that we did not hold was sufficient that we could make the determination for qualified immunity, and we had to go the case had to go on to trial. So I take it neither side has a specific case from our circuit that we've dealt with this before that you wish to cite to us.
No, Your Honor, I do not. All I know is that there's a lot of questions on qualified immunity in all the circuits, and that the Supreme Court tomorrow is conferencing on all those cases that are that search were filed.
Yes, it would be wonderful from that conference if they would give us an opinion. We know exactly how to handle it. And I take it that you'll keep us advised if that silver bullet comes along so that we can dispose of the case without being reversed by our more learned brethren from D.C. Thanks for your comments.
That, Your Honor, that may be waiting to see what happens. May 15th, maybe, and put this all to rest.
Yes, well, we would like some guidance on it, so please advise us when that comes out. It's interesting they're conferencing on so many of those.
Agreed, Your Honor. So, I don't think there's anything else I need to say other than that this case should not be looked at in a vacuum as the officer sees a toy gun, thinks it's a real gun, and fears for his life. I think that phrase is overused, and I think qualified immunity was a good idea at the beginning, but the pendulum swung in the opposite direction, and it's now being used on every shooting, qualified immunity, a fear for my life. And put this case in context, these officers had every advantage to this young man on the street at night. He never threatened them. He never approached them. He wasn't doing anything other than walking. He did not even react to them when they drove by in a police car. It seems reasonable that if a person was doing something wrong, either he would have shot at the police or he would have been running. He did nothing. And so where this hate and fear and scrutiny comes from by the police officers, they add that later on about the AR-15, as if, you know, the use of force is somehow justified greater because he had plastic AR-15 as compared to something else. So on that point, we will submit the case. Thank you.
Thank you, counsel. We've turned to rebuttal. We'll give 2 minutes for rebuttal.
Thank you, Your Honor. Judge Nelson, I think you are correct in noting that the facts are not disputed. They're simply not corroborated by someone other than the deputies. And under...
So I think that may be correct as a technical matter. Although the deputies do have some inconsistent statements. But what do we do where the plaintiff has deceased here? I mean, the plaintiff was shot. Don't we have a stronger duty to look at the circumstantial evidence and sort of, look at the facts a little more carefully?
Yes, that is the standard in the circuit, where the person most likely to contradict the deputies is no longer available to testify. You're supposed to carefully examine the record, including circumstantial evidence, for evidence that would place the deputies testimony in doubt. And that is what happened in the-
But isn't all that circumstantial evidence here tied up in, I mean, ultimately, isn't it a question about how much fear they had? How much fear the deputies actually had?
No. I mean, how much fear they had is actually the perfect issue for interlocutory review, because that's a reasonableness standard based on the facts. But the facts here are undisputed. It's the court treating the facts as disputed, even though they're undisputed, because of a lack of corroborating evidence. And that is not the standard, even in cases in this circuit where the decedent didn't survive.
But if we found that the facts are inconclusive as to, that they would support a range of different fears, and at least one view of the facts would suggest that the officers did not have enough fear to have fired a shot or either shot, at least the second shot, maybe we could find jurisdiction, but then wouldn't we just send it back for trial anyway?
No, I think what you're looking at is whether the use of force was reasonable or a violation of clearly established law based on the facts taken in the light most favorable to the plaintiff to the extent supportable by the record. And here, the only facts supportable by the record are that he aimed the handgun at them before they fired. They were trying to get him to disarm for 3 minutes, and he aimed the handgun. That is when the fatal shots were fired. Those facts are undisputed.
Okay. Anything? Yeah. Thank you, counsel. Both counsel, you've been helpful on this case. And we will submit the case. And that concludes our argument calendar for today. So thank you very much.
Thank you, Your Honor.